Africa, a people for whom music was a way of speaking. From Europe, the musical instruments, the shapes, the forms. In America, the fusion, and the birth of a new music, jazz. Tonight, the music comes to Washington, D.C., and the Smithsonian, an institution that illuminates the American experience, including the music born in America, jazz. Tonight at the Smithsonian, Art Blakey and the Jazz Messengers. Art Blakey has played the drums for more than 40 years. From 1955 to the present, he has brought into his Jazz Messengers young musicians who later became stars themselves. Art Blakey is something more than simply a great drummer.
They didn't know I had a different way of playing, and they didn't understand it. People didn't understand because they had taken the drums from, I was a follower of Chick Webb, you know, taking the drums from being 14 musicians and the drummer to 15 musicians, and taking the drums from back in the back and timekeeping and bringing the drums forward, you know, and making it more musical.
Art Blakey and the Jazz Messengers. Jazz at the Smithsonian. Thank you.
Thank you.
Art Blakey and the Jazz Messengers will return for the second half of their Smithsonian concert. At his home in New York, we talked with Art about why he left the piano for the drums and about the time he played drums in the Billy Eckstein band.
You mentioned that you began playing drums with Fletcher Henderson, 1939, and I think it's fantastic that you began as a pianist, but they found another pianist in Pittsburgh they liked better.
Well, no, I wasn't a pianist, I was a piano player.
All right.
A pianist come in and took my job, you see. We had a show.
You care to give his name?
Huh? Oh, Errol Garner.
Errol Garner, right.
So I got up to the piano, and this guy in the corner said, "Can I try it out?" It was Earl. See, I knew Earl. See, Earl was on the air. He was a pro then, a kid, about 8, 9 years old. He's on the air, Gumdrops, with some talented kids. I said, "Sure." And the band run it down. He got the piano part. Not only played it, he added to it. And that was it. So the guy on the club was sitting in the corner and said, "Hey, Blakey, come over here." And I said, "What you want?" He says, he had a big Magnum on his side. He says, you play the drums and let this other kid play the piano. I said, "Uh-oh, now you're going to call the sets and tell us what to do." I said, "It's my band." He said, "How long you been here?" I said, "About 2.5 years. He said, "You want to stay?" I said, "Of course I want to stay." He said, "Well, you dumb bastard, get up there and play the drums." Well, I did. I joined the band in St. Louis, and I didn't know who these guys were.
Billy Eckstein.
Yeah. I had met Charlie Parker in a train station in St. Louis. I talked with him a while, but I never knew Sarah Vaughan or Dizzy Gillespie, all these guys, and Freddie Webster in this band. And I had no idea what the band was all about until that night. And we opened up in the Plantation in St. Louis, Missouri. So the guy came down at rehearsal. He says, "Now the band," Jeta Pillar had been there for years. And he said, "Now when you get off the stage," he said, "when all the band come back, this is your room, you know. And when you come to work in the back door through the kitchen." And so Billy Holiday said, "Ooh, I don't come through no kitchen, you know." So that night, when the guys come to work, I was setting up my drums, and lo and behold, the place was full of people, and they were eating dinner. The front door comes Billie Holiday, Dizzy Gillespie, Billy Eckstein, Charlie Parker, and Sarah Vaughan. They walked in front of us, "Oh, my God." So we opened up that night, and we played. They didn't know what we were playing. This big band played more like a combo than the big band, you know, and we did a lot of things, and very intricate. And I liked the band very much, but people didn't understand and they didn't know anything. But we didn't get any publicity because the office wasn't interested in the musicians. And all these stars they had in the band, they didn't have sense enough to realize that. And they couldn't look that far because they themselves didn't know anything about this new music, see. And we went down to California, we played there, and a lady come up to interview us, you know, and she came up and she heard, watched the show. So she wrote about the band. She said, "Well," she didn't understand what we were playing there. We were playing something from another planet. And said that Gene Ammons looked like a big snorting black bull with fire snorting from his nostrils. And he come to the microphone, said, "The drummer, Art Blake, he looked like a little black pygmy back here behind those white drums. They were going to eat the white man tonight." Everybody got mad at her, you know. They got mad at her, so I didn't. I thanked her for it, you know. Because when they don't say nothing about you, you're in trouble.
Thank you.
Charles Clambo. Bradford Marcellus. Billy Pierce, ladies and gentlemen. Yeah. Our musical director, Winton Marcellus, ladies and gentlemen. At the drums is Mrs. Blakey's one and only Bambino. Yours truly, Arturo Blakey, me. Thank you. Thank you. We'll be right back.